Okay, my audible. Seems like I'm audible. Neat. Oh, I'm tired. Oh, jeez. Okay, all right, let's see if my students are here. Students. Good morning, Theo. All right, the students, please react to that message if you are present. I appreciate the skull reacts. That's how I feel right now. Okay. All right. Neat. I need to open Photoshop. Need to open a bunch of things. Also need to open my notes. How did the assignment go? The turret assignment. Did anyone do all of them, including the special one, or what was the general progress? You did all of them? Damn, including the smoothing? Because if so, I'm gonna put on cat ears, as promised. I couldn't make mine shoot because a laser refused to point forwards even though the previous exercises did. That is weird. Oh, you know what, Carolina? Have you double checked that you're using vector threes in your code? Because it could be that you're still using vector twos for the 2D laser. And if so, it's not gonna do anything on the z-axis, right? Maybe? It's a guess. Okay, including smoothing. Neat. Now, are we gonna get a sleepy teacher with cat ears? Congrats, I suppose. All right, okay. I was doing something, just not sure what. Okay. Yeah, strange. Okay. Well, let's get into it. Let's open our document. Hope the assignments have been useful. I noticed that some of you were a little bit confused as for like what was the right answer on the which assignment was it? The first one I gave this time around. So hope it wasn't too vague, and I hope it was still useful. Where are my notes? Right, turret assignment 4, the turret alignment one. Sometimes it can be tricky to know what the right answer is for things that are kind of like, kind of vibes based. Like when you're placing a turret, there are many, many correct answers depending on what you want it to feel like when you're placing a turret. And so it can be a little tricky to figure out exactly how it should behave. There was one answer that many of you did that I was, that I consider to be quote unquote the correct answer. But again, it's game development. You kind of just go for whatever feels best for the player in this case, especially something that's so closely related to the gameplay, like player experience, right? Okay. Well, let's go back to our turret. Oh shit, I need to fix my desktop. Hold on. There we go. Okay, I'm pretty tired, so I apologize if I'm slow or if I miss something. Just as usual, let me know if you have questions. If something is unclear, I am more than happy to clarify and explain something again or whatever. Okay. So the first assignment, let's see. Sorry, I guess it should be assignment 4, was to fix the bug that I introduced. It was totally intentional that I introduced this bug so that you would have this assignment. So there's a bug in the code that I wrote that made the turret not really look forwards. There were some edge cases where if there's a slope to the side, the turret didn't really look forward. It felt like it was looking in a different direction. Oh, I might not actually have the turret here still. Okay, so let's... I think I might have forgotten to save the scene, or no, Unity crashed. That's what happened. So my scene changes were not changed or not saved. So I need to recreate this. Turret placer. Okay. So we want to place a turret. I made a turret model using Unity primitives, and so now I have a turret that looks a little bit better than 4 cubes. it's going to make it easier to do the rest of the, to show the rest of this assignment. And so it's going to, let's see, that's the placer, and that one needs a reference to that. And there we go. Okay. So, now if we move the... with the transform, see that it's placing the turret. I think I might have already fixed the code now. Oh geez, I forgot to revert those changes. Oh no, I can't show the bug now, I think. But this was what it was supposed to do. Oh yeah, so this is the fixed version. So basically what happened was that when I did this one last time, I used the wrong axis for my cross products. I was calculating the x-axis from the dot product between the normal of the surface and the forward vector of the camera. The problem that happened when doing that was that the turret was like slightly tilting to the side. So like if you aligned it with the camera's Y vector, the forward vector of the turret could point in a different direction. Like they weren't flat together. And that made it seem like the turret was kind of like looking to the side, especially when you were looking down, it was like turning left. And that feels wrong. And so the solution is to use the cross products between the normal of the surface and the right vector of the camera. And so that way we actually do get a vector that is parallel or perpendicular to both the normal of the surface and the right vector of the camera. And that gives us a forward vector that is aligned properly with those axes. And so that was the first, I believe that was 4B. So that is how to solve that one. Basically, you just use the wrong vectors. As using the camera, right vector is the correct solution there. Well, one of the correct solutions, depending on how you want to align your turret. I guess we can try a more extreme case as well. So what if you want to place it on a wall? Let's see if that works out. That does not work out the way that I would expect it to. So this one is now not working the way that I would expect. As you can see, it's hard. But it works better in this case. So I guess there are two cases. One is you're kind of looking down. And in this case, I think most people would expect it to point upwards, right? And I suspect that our old solution was probably better in the wall case, whereas this one is worse in the wall case. Okay, so if you wanna noodle with turret placement forever and ever, you can keep doing that, I suppose. We have more bugs or new features. That's true, Nestor. That's a good perspective. But anyway, so kind of the point of this whole exercise is that you kind of realize that spaces and rotations and orientations are pretty hard to deal with in general. You quite often run into many edge cases, and it can be really hard to wrap your head around what's even happening, because sometimes it's hard to think in 3D. It's like on 2D, you can kind of draw everything on paper, but in 3D, that's harder, right? So I think a more proper solution would probably interpolate between the two cases, I think. So like if you're looking down like onto the surface, then we'd probably use this solution. But if you're looking toward a wall, then we should probably blend toward the other solution that we had before. Because I think that one is a little bit more robust, because that one explicitly aligned with the cross product between the normal and the forward vector, and I think that would be better in this case. But I could be wrong. But if you wanna research that and figure that out, then you're welcome to do so. But this was the intended solution. Okay. So. All right, then we have assignment 5, the turret trigger. So the point of the turret trigger is to kind of similar to the trigger where we had a spherical trigger, where if you're inside a certain radius, we want something to activate, and when you're outside, we want it to deactivate. Or rather, we just want to detect if something is within a certain radius, right? So I believe, did we do that here? I might have deleted that. Yeah, I think I deleted that. Or rather, it wasn't saved. We lost that too. But you remember the trigger. We had a radius if you were inside. We had a bool that returned true. If you're outside, we had a bool that returned false. But in this case, we have a more complicated situation, right? Like this shape is a little bit more tricky to make a trigger for. A sphere is literally just checking distance to a point. But this one, there's more going on, right? So we have a cylinder-like shape, but the cylinder is also angularly cut off, and it also has a maximum height. So whenever you're making this type of like combined trigger, you can sort of think of it as a Venn diagram of, let's say you have a some region, you're checking distance to a thing, right? This is the regular distance check. And then let's say you're checking the distance to a different thing. And so if you, I don't know if you know about the whole concept of Boolean operations, but if you check whether or not you're inside both of these circles, then the region you're going to check is the union of these two regions, right? And so there's a similar concept we're doing here, except we're doing it with 3D shapes. And so if there is a, if we look at this one, we can kind of split it up into, we can split it up into three different things that we need to be inside, right? So the first one is the height, right? So if we make some sort of 3D space, then it's kind of hard to draw infinite planes, but if you imagine the bottom plane, and then we have the top plane, these should probably be aligned. This is beautiful. Just trust me that this is great. So in this case, we have a plane at the bottom, and then there's another plane that is higher up on the y-axis, right? And so the first check, just imagine that these planes are infinitely stretching in all directions. We want to check if something is between these two, right? And so that would be kind of the first circle in our Venn diagram. We want to check if we are within a certain height. And then the next shape is an infinite cylinder. So if you imagine a cylinder that is stretching to infinity in both directions, we want to check if we are inside of the cylinder. And so now, same concept as with these circles, the union of these two shapes, in other words, the infinite cylinder and this little slice of height, right? The union of that is going to be the volume that is shared by both of them. So by doing this infinite cylinder and then cutting it off, we've effectively created a limited cylinder. So now the region we're checking is specifically the cylinder within that height range. I don't know how to draw two exactly similar ellipses. There we go. So now we have a cylinder check. Because we made an infinite cylinder, and then we check if we are inside of that, and if we are inside this specific height range, then we are checking if we're inside this specific cylinder. And so now we've had these, was it an intersection? Oh yeah, it might be intersection, not union. I think union might be the whole thing. Intersection is probably these two. Yeah, so we're intersecting. I don't know, look, I said that I was tired. So I blame my sleepiness. But yeah, so if we intersect those two, this is what we get. All right, and then we have one more thing. Because the trigger doesn't have that shape, we want to also limit the angular space of this one. And so that's going to be kind of similar to the first like two planes we have here. It's kind of like we have two more infinite planes that are stretching in, this is going to be hard to draw, but basically one plane that is stretching out like this, and one plane that is kind of going toward the camera, like this. So we want to check if we are on the front side of both of these planes. If we're on the back side, it shouldn't return true, but if we're on the front of both of them, then we should be inside the trigger. And if we do that, then finally we have created this little cheese wedge, And that's the volume we want to check. Yes, intersection, that's the one. Okay. Did that make sense, like mathematically? What's going on here? You can sort of imagine each shape being like an if statement, checking if something is within the shape or not. Do we really need those planes? You don't physically have to define them as planes. You can define them in many different ways. And we're not going to implement them as planes. We're going to implement them in a different way. But it's more like the mental model is that, basically. For the height check, I just did if absolute value of difference in position is less than height. Yes, that works if you're on flat terrain. Because part of the assignment was to also do this in local space. So if you rotate the turret, then the trigger should also rotate with it. But you are checking world space coordinates there. And so those coordinates won't rotate when you rotate the trigger. But yes, that is basically doing the height check. It's just that yours is doing it in world space, right? So that is, even though we drew planes, mathematically in code, it generally just looks like something like your code, right? Like you check the absolute value of the difference from some center, and that, then you check the thresholds and then you're done, basically. Okay, I briefly mentioned in the document that drawing this is actually a little bit harder. Like drawing this in a gizmo, it's a little bit harder than just solving the problem itself. But I think it's better to start drawing it in this case, because you can actually do that without using angles. And I think that might be useful if you want me to do that, but maybe it's not interesting, but I think it would be interesting. So let's start making our trigger. I think usually when you make things like this, it's quite useful to just do it in an isolated context. So instead of attaching it to the turret directly, it's better if we just do this in an isolated game object, unrelated to all of the other things. Okay. So what do we call this? What's a good name? What shape is this? Is this a cheese trigger? Because it's a cheese wedge. Maybe cheese trigger is the correct word. Cake trigger, cylindrical sector. But that's not as fun, right? It's like, that's accurate, but... Okay, wedge trigger then. Somewhere in between. We get none of the best of any worlds, just worst of both worlds. Okay. Call it slice, that works, yeah. Okay, let's draw the gizmo. Okay. So what do we want to draw? We want to draw something that can represent this, right? And so let's start with, let's see, maybe we'll start with the rings at the top and the bottom. So if we're in Unity, we can use the handles. handles function for that. And the handles function has a thing called draw wire disk. And so we want to draw that at the location of this object, right? Then we need the radius. So we need to have some parameters for the trigger. We need radius. We need, let's see. So we need the height. And finally, we need some sort of angular threshold. So the threshold we're going to use is not going to be an actual angle. It's just a threshold. And I'm going to turn this into a slider from 0 to 1. Because I magically know that that's going to be the range we're interested in. Might want some default values. There we go. Wouldn't it be negative 1 to 1? It could be, yeah, if you want to. I guess it depends on what range you would like for your turret. But my turret doesn't support that, I'm pretty sure. Because I think the gun of my turret would start intersecting other shapes if I go too far, you know? But you can, but it, the full range is negative 1 to 1, yes. All right. Should probably disable these again. Wedge trigger. Okay. So the wire disk. To draw a wire disk, you need a position, the center of the disk, and then you need a normal. And we talked a little bit about normals. So the normal is the a vector that is perpendicular to a point on a surface. So in this case, the surface is the disk itself. So this is kind of telling us, or we're telling the draw wire disk function what direction we want the disk to point in, right? And in this case, we want it to be aligned with the y-axis. Again, because if we want to rotate this, we want the disk to rotate with it. So we're going to do transform.up. And then the radius. So we just pass in our radius variable. And then I believe that should draw a disk. Look at that disk. Isn't that beautiful? Can change the radius. And now we've got a gizmo. All right, next up, we need to take height into account. So we need to draw the upper one as well. Handles doesn't exist for me. So you need to include Unity Editor in order to use handles. I don't know if your IDE like auto includes namespaces. So you're going to need Unity Editor. It is there? Okay, that's weird. That sounds like your IDE might be broken then. I'm not sure why that would be broken. I guess try to restart. I guess you could delete the C# cached files in the project or something. Like close your IDE, close Unity, delete the temporary files in Unity, the like CS proj and whatnot. To restart the router. But yeah, delete the library folder and the CS proj and the SLN. Just nuke everything. Just those two and the library folder. Be sure to close the Unity and Writer before you do that. Okay, so we want to take height into account. So we need to draw the top cap of this one. So to do that, we're going to have to draw another disk, but we need to offset it by the up direction, right? And by the length that is height. So in this case, we're going to use the same normal, but we need a different position. And I'm going to introduce some variables here. So we need the origin. So that's going to be transformed on position. Just to make the code a little bit more readable. So up, transform dot up. Okay, so we can define a new vector that is the top of our cylinder. So the top of our cylinder is going to be the origin plus the up vector. And then we scale the up vector by the height. Because remember, when you multiply a normalized vector by a value, it's going to set the length of that vector to that value. So now we're offsetting exactly by the height. So this gives us the position of the top of our cylinder. And that's going to be the second disk. And there we go. So now we can set the height and we can set the radius. So we've kind of done the two of the things we needed to do, right? We're doing the vertical slicing and the radial slicing, but now we need to do the angular slicing. And this is the fun part. Let's go back to Photoshop. Okay. So now we need to have some way to check some form of angular threshold. But in our case, we haven't actually talked anything about angles or trigonometry. And I wanted you to solve this without using angles or trigonometry, and instead use only the things we've talked about, which is also cheaper than doing this using trigonometry. And so I mentioned it briefly last time that the dot product has many different use cases or many different situations that kind of call for different interpretations of what's going on. So we have scalar projection. When one of the vectors is normalized, it's kind of like we're projecting B perpendicularly onto A, and then we're getting the distance where B is along A, or the signed distance, rather. So this was the case where we have a normalized vector, and then we project another vector that's not normalized onto the normalized vector, and then we get the distance along A. And this is a signed distance because it can be negative. And another use case that I'm not sure if it has a name, but if both of them are normalized, we get this situation right here, where if you consider that the blue vector here being some sort of normalized vector, and then the red vector here is the other vector. But crucially, both of them are normalized this time. And when both of them are normalized, the dot product between these two kind of sort of represents something that is similar to an angle. It's not an angular measurement, but it does strictly decrease around the circle. And it strictly increases in this direction. So if the vectors are pointing in the same direction, the dot product is 1. When they're pointing in opposite directions, the dot product is -1. When they're pointing perpendicular to each other, the dot product is 0. And so it's perpendicular in both directions here. And then if you start moving this vector closer, the value is going to increase until it finally increases all the way to 1. And so our dot product can actually be used as a substitute for checking angles. We can use it directly to try to see how similar are these two vectors. And in this case, the two vectors that we want to use is the forward direction of the trigger. That's a blue one here. And then the red one, that's going to be the direction to your target. So it's going to be like some sort of enemy. Here, this is an enemy. This is what enemies look like. So it's going to be the direction to the enemy. And specifically, we need to normalize that vector. So we can't just subtract. We also have to normalize it to make sure that we get, to make sure that it has a length of 1, so that we can do this kind of angular measurement, right? And so really, if we want to make an angular test like this, instead of setting an angle, we can just decide what number, what result of the dot product should be inside versus outside the trigger. And so if we set it to 0.2, then we're going to have a very wide trigger, right? It's going to be very, very large. If we set it to 0.8, we're going to have a very narrow trigger. And so all we're going to do is we're going to simply check what the dot product is. And if it's less than or greater than our angular threshold, it's either inside or outside. Okay, so that's that part. But we now have a bit of a tricky problem, because drawing this is actually a little bit harder than just making that angular check. So I think we could start by doing the check itself, and then we can do the drawing of that threshold. Okay, so let's give this one a target. We're just going to hard code this because we don't care. No fancy code of detecting things. I don't have my water here. I should probably have water. Okay, we need a target. Can we borrow this one? This one says A. Maybe that's a valid target. Yeah, I should stay hydrated. This is true. All right. So we have a target. And now we need to check if it's, start doing the checks if it's inside this whole thing. All right, so there are a few ways to do this. In fact, there are many ways of doing it. So we're going to add a function called contains that simply checks if a position is contained within this shape. Okay, actually, I don't know which order is best. Do you want me to do the drawing first and then the check? Or do we do the check and then the drawing? Cast your vote. Drawing or check or test. This is drawing. Drawing. Okay. It's a little bit easier to visualize if it's drawing. Okay, 4 votes on drawing, 1 vote for test. Okay. 1 vote for doesn't matter. Okay, yeah, let's keep drawing then. Okay. Oh, you recall your vote. You changed. Okay. Did you change just due to public pressure? All right, drawing. So traditionally, you would do stuff like this using angles, but because I'm rude and I'm an asshole, I'm like, oh, you should do this without using angles. And also because we haven't talked about angles or trigonometry yet, we need to figure out how to solve like the actual directions in this situation, right? So let's draw this in an isolated situation over here. Okay, I'm going to attempt to draw a circle again. Oh god. It's not centered. Okay, what if I do it on a separate layer? And then I just move it. I know there are circle tools in Photoshop. Don't remind me. Okay, good enough. All right. So the thing we have to solve now is that we have some vector that is the forward of the turret, right? So we're just gonna draw that. Actually, I guess I could use the actual colors for the forward vector. And then we have the direction to the target. And let's say, or rather, no, well, yeah, so we're gonna have a direction to a target, right? And then we're gonna check if the dot product is less than or greater than a certain threshold, right? And so really, what we're doing when we're checking the direction to the player, or when we do the dot product, we're projecting onto this, and the distance we're getting is this. And so we actually have this distance. And so if I'm just gonna mark that. I don't know what color to use. So this distance right here, this is our projected distance. I'm just gonna call that P. And so what we want to draw is that we want to draw this vector, right? Where we know P, that's our angular threshold for our wedge, right? So P is a known value. And then we need to figure out, okay, so what direction is this? So we're gonna have to figure out this length. We need to know how long this is in order for us to figure out this vector. But so far we have one known value, and this is unknown. And then the hypotenuse is actually known as well because this is normalized. This has a length of one. And so now we're actually just back to Pythagoras, right? This is a triangle, and we can solve for any of the sides of triangles using the Pythagorean theorem, right? And so what the Pythagorean theorem says is that P squared plus x squared equals 1 squared. So a squared plus b squared equals c squared. This is the Pythagorean theorem, except we've used the values we have here, right? And so now we can just do regular equation solving to figure out the value of x. I don't know. We actually haven't talked about equation solving in this course, and I'm not sure how much you want us to talk about that, because I have no idea what your like skill level is when it comes to that kind of stuff. But you do a lot of that in school, so I'm hoping you remember a lot of that. Okay. So basically, when it comes to equation solving, if you want to find the value of a certain thing, all it really comes down to is to do the same operation on either side of the equation until you've isolated the variable you're interested in. So effectively, all it boils down to is, is to find a way to shuffle this around. So for instance, if we take P2 and subtract P2 from both sides, so we can simplify this. So first off, the 1 squared is just 1, right? 1 times 1 is 1, so that's straightforward enough. And then we can subtract p squared from both sides. So if we do that, we're going to get minus... I've forgotten how to draw a p. So minus p squared, and if we subtract p squared, obviously that's going to just cancel out and get deleted from this side. And so we've effectively just moved it to the other side. And then x squared is just staying on the same side there. All right, and then the final step is to get rid of this cube, sorry, cube, square. We need to get rid of the square. And the square root of something squared is just the value inside of it, right? So the square root of x squared is x. So if we do the square root on both sides, the square root and the 2 is going to cancel out. And so, eventually, we're going to end up with x equals the square root of 1 minus p squared. Okay. So now we've solved it. We've solved for this length here. And so what we now have is that we actually have the local space coordinates for this vector. And the vector has a length of 1 because we decided that in this problem, right? And so we can use this formula to figure out where this should point given our angular threshold that we got from the dot product, the p. Okay, so let's implement this. Okay. Did that make sense, by the way? Are there any questions about this? Perfect sense. Okay, good. Yeah, because I figure you do a lot of equation solving in school, and so, you know. You know. Probably shouldn't talk too much about that. All right, so we need, first we need the value of p, the projected value. So that's just a float, because again, the dot product just gives you a float. So I'm just going to call that p to match our diagram. So p is effectively just our angular threshold. And then we need to figure out x. So float x equals the square root of 1 minus our angular threshold squared, or sorry, p. And I believe that's the same as our equation. 1 minus p squared, yeah. Okay. So now we need to convert this into vectors that we can use in our diagram here. Messed up when I did it. I assumed that a dot product of 0.5 would just be a diagonal. Yeah, that's a classic one, because this is a diagonal, right? Well, close to, but it's going to have a value that's higher than 0.5. So this is going to be like 0.707 something. And this is a value you're gonna start to recognize. So that's the value of the dot product if it's 45 degrees. Okay, so now we have these, we have the value p and we have the value x, but those are just numbers here, right? So we need to convert this into a vector in world space, because we're drawing in world space, right? All right, so so what we need to do is we need to take the origin of this, and then we start adding vectors on top, just like we did for the local to world. So now we're effectively doing a local to world conversion. So we're going to do, let's see, do we do the origin? No, we should specify the relative vectors first, I think. Yeah, we should do that. Okay. So we're going to do vector 3. V right, because we're going to have two of them. So that's going to be transform dot forward. So that's the blue. Woo. Thanks, Photoshop. So this blue vector here is transform dot forward. So we're going to multiply that by p. So now it's basically a vector projection. So transform.forward times p, and then plus, we're going to do transform.right, which is this vector right here. Pretty sure it's the square root of 0.5. I think it's the inverse of the square root of 2. I think that's the value, but I'm not sure if it's the square root of 0.5. It might actually be the same value. Okay, transform.right times x. So x is the value we calculated. So maybe we should do these intermediate things again. Just have some, make it a little bit more clear. Okay, so now we have a vector in world space, and then we should draw this. So we're going to do gizmos, draw line. Actually, I guess we can use draw array. So we have the origin, and then the vector we want to draw it in is v right. So that's our direction. And then we want the left direction. So basically we're doing the same thing, except we're taking the negative of this. So it's going to be negative x. And then that gives us the other direction, right? Okay, Photoshop freaks out when I try to use the mouse when I've been using the tablet. I don't know why. So left is going to be the same thing, except we negate x. I feel like left should be before right. All right, let's see if this works. I have an error. What did I do? Oh. Left unfinished business. And there we go. Now we have some sort of wedge. And now we can try to see what happens if we modify our threshold. If it's near zero, you can see that it covers the full 180 degrees. And if we increase it, it's going to be more narrow. So one thing that it doesn't do now is that it doesn't take the radius into account. But these are normalized, so all we need to do is multiply these by the radius. And so let's just do that. So we multiply our vectors by the radius. And that extends them or shortens them to be the same length to reach the edge of our trigger. So now we can change radius, and we have our little angular threshold there. Okay. And then we might want to do the same thing. We want to draw these on top of it as well. So we're going to do draw from the top position, but the same relative vectors. Just to make it a little bit more wedge-like. There we go. And then we might want to draw the vertical lines as well. So draw line. So that's going to be origin plus v left, and then top plus v left. And then we're going to do the same thing with the right one. And then we're going to do another one that's just origin and top. So that's the center line. So if we go back, we should have our lines here. There we go. Now we've drawn a sort of visual for this little cheese wedge. And we can change the angular threshold. We can change the height. And there we go. We did it without using trigonometry. All right. Did that make sense? Everything we're doing here, it's very much a bunch of vector math for just adding things together. It's all good. Okay. All right. People are typing. Oh, and we also haven't tested if this works in different spaces. Isn't the Pythagorean theorem trigonometry? So technically, did we use it? I'm not sure if it is trigonometry. Maybe it is, but I don't think it would count. It doesn't count in my view. In my view, trigonometry requires the use of angles. And then you immediately get to the trigonometric functions. Maybe the Pythagorean theorem counts as trigonometry, but I think that then it's a bad definition in my view. But I guess it is a measurement of a triangle, so who knows? Can you post the code in chat? Yeah. There you go, code. Oh yeah, I need water. I'll be right back. Oh yeah, how are we doing on breaks? Oh yeah, we should do our first break. Okay, 10-minute break, I suppose. Seems like there's a delay. Make sure you're live on YouTube. There's like a... Oh, 2 to 3 seconds? Yeah, 2 to 3 seconds is basically... I don't think we can do much better than that. Yeah, sometimes if there's a hitch on YouTube, you might start falling a little bit behind. So you might have to like make sure to click the live button to catch up. But I think 2 to 3 seconds is, I don't think we can get any better than that. Okay. Water. We're taking a break. So we're going to resume at 10:10. So I'll be right back. Resuming at 10:10. I just have to, look at this boy. This boy. He's just been there all this time.
Hey, Fallon. Hello. Hey. Hey, Fallon. Oh, Leon. Leon. Hey.
Innovative chair user, yeah. Water, right.
Hey.
Is that chair just for cats? You know, there's a lot of cats in all of our chairs, but this one is not a dedicated cat chair. That's Ashley's chair. But we do have a dedicated cat chair.
Hey,
you're dropping it. And the dedicated cat chair is over there behind me. It's kind of hard to see. There we go. That's my old chair, so we've just donated it to the cats. So they're free to destroy that one.
Hey! Hello!
Where are the others? Well, the others... There's Thor. And in the top basket over there, on top of our flower tree, is Toast. So Thor is drinking water, Toast is napping, and Salad is being Salad.
Wow, wow, wow. Sneeze! What a big sneeze!
Oh, last time you got your cat a bed, she decided a sheet of A4 was better. Yeah. I mean, they like to sleep on shapes that are approximately their own size. So you just got to make sure you have enough cat-sized shapes that they can sleep on. We have a lot of, like, tiny little cat beds. Like the ones on the floor here, the brown ones. So these are just tiny little sockets that they like napping in. Yep. It's good to have those scattered around. Okay. I got my water. Oh no, Salad left.
Salad!
Salad has changed location. He's now hanging out on the floor. This is a good break. This is how you do breaks. I just joined. What is this? This is Salad. This is my baby boy. And I love him very much.
Hey. Hello.
You have a bit of a... Yeah, dried snot.
That looks uncomfortable. I had to fix it. What? What? Where are you going? Where are you going? What's up to? What's up to, Zelen?
Pressing your butt against my monitor. Okay. Bye, Zelen. Yep, they left. Toast is still napping out there. I think Thor might. Oh, there's a Thor. Hey, Thor.
Thor. Hey. Hello. What's up?
Okay. It's Thor's stream now. Is this true? Oh, okay. He's wandering off. He's got business to attend. Okay. Valid. All right, 2 minutes left. Shit, I kind of wish I had time to make more tea. I'll just go boil some water and I'll do it. Eventually, I'm gonna need tea, so. All right, guess we should resume, or I guess we have 1 minute left. 1 minute of random questions before I resume. Sorry about the boiling water in the background. I just need tea. It's what fuels me, so. I also didn't eat anything for breakfast, so I should just keep drinking tea as a substitute. If we want to draw handles.bezier, what tangents do we use? Well, it depends on what shape you want to draw, right? So that depends on what shape you would like to do. Which is the best season of the year? I like the non-extreme seasons. I like spring and I like fall. I don't like summer because it's too warm, and I don't like winter because it's too cold. I really like the other ones. I'm a little bit biased towards fall because I like rain. It's very cozy, especially because I'm mostly indoors. So fall is probably my favorite season. If you want to use the Bezier to draw the turret trigger. Well, you don't want to get me talking too much about Bezier curves, because I've been knee-deep in Bezier curves and splines for like 2 years. So I could go ridiculously in depth about this. If you want to draw like the circular arc using a Bezier curve, is that what you're asking? Yeah, so there are a few things. Bezier curves can't draw circles. You can approximate a circle using Bezier curves, but you can't make circular arcs. And so the short answer is it's the wrong shape for that purpose. And so I would use something else to draw that. The thing you should use to draw a circular arc is a function called handles.drawWireArc. The one thing though is that this one requires an angle, and we haven't talked about trigonometry yet. And so, but this is the one you would use. You just need to know the angle of this one. But it's possible. So that's the function you would use. Okay. Trying not to go on a 5-hour tangent on Bezier curves and splines. All right. Okay. Let's resume. Let's ping. Is it annoying that I ping everyone? I don't know if I should ping after every break, but. There we go. We're resuming. React to show your presence for Thor. I appreciate how many Thor emotes we have on the FutureGames 21 Discord. That's good. Okay, cool. Neat. Right. What was our next step? Right. We're not actually doing any testing to test if we're inside or outside. Okay. But there is one more thing that I want to talk about. So what we've been doing here is that we have been we've kind of been meticulously doing a lot of math operations here, specifically because we want this to be in local space, right? We want this to be relative to this transform, because we want to be able to move this around and rotate it and everything, and we want the gizmo to follow this one, right? However, there is a much easier way to do this. Because this is kind of cluttered. Everything we've done so far is kind of just using all of the vectors we have for this transform and kind of doing all the vector math to like stack vectors together to get all the directions we want and so forth. But one thing that is super, super useful in general, not just for this, is that we can actually draw gizmos relative to some space. And so to do that, we can simply do gizmos.matrix. So we're going to set the matrix of the gizmos to transform.localToWorldMatrix. And so now this will make all gizmo drawing relative to this transform. And so this will actually simplify a lot of this code. Because now what's going to happen is that instead of origin being transform.position, origin is just going to be 0, right? Vector3.0, that is the center of our local coordinates. That's the origin. And so if we do this, we can actually simplify this a huge amount. And so I think just for the sake of comparison, I'm gonna copy this code so we can compare them afterwards. So again, here's another use case for matrices. They're very, very, very good. Okay, so let's see what happens when we do this. If we set the matrix to the local to world matrix, all of the drawing is going to be relative to this transform. So now if we do gizmos.drawSphere, and if we draw that one at vector3.0 with a radius of something, I'm just going to comment out everything else. So if we draw a sphere at 0, I go back now, everything should disappear, but we should get a little sphere. So now, if I move this, you can see that the gizmos are moving with this object, even though we're telling it to just draw at 0. Because now, the context of our drawing has changed so that we're drawing it relative to the local-to-world matrix. So everything is going to be transformed by that matrix. So now, 0 is our new origin. So let's see what happens when we change the origin to 0. So effectively, that means that we can kind of just delete the origin. So the top coordinate is now going to be origin plus up, but origin, again, is just 0. 0 plus something is just 0, because it's the additive identity. So we can just delete that. Draw wire disk, we want to draw that at the origin, which is just vector3.0. We're going to use that. And here, again, we want to draw from 0. We could also type defaults if we want to. Default is just a default value of the struct. So this will be equivalent to 0. You can use either. I like using defaults, but 0 is a little bit more explicit. And so again, here we have origin plus something. We can just delete those two, because again, 0 plus something is just something. So we can delete those. What else? Okay, and then we have our relative vectors here. So now up is just going to be vector3.up. In other words, this is going to be equivalent to 0, 1, 0. Right is going to be 1, 0, 0. Forward is going to be 0, 0, 1. And these are equivalent to, should probably order them. So this is equivalent to vector3.right. So that's the same thing. We're just using different words. And so what's going to happen here is that this will actually simplify a lot too. Because now, remember our the value for p and the value for x, these are already in local space. This is just the value along the z-axis, and this is the value along the x-axis. And so we can just directly get our vector from these two values. And so our new vLeft, so that is just going to be new vector 3. Along the x-axis, we have our value x, y-axis 0, and on the z-axis, we have p. And then we want to multiply that by the radius. So now this whole line here, this whole mess of like multiplying and adding vectors, all of that's gone. And so now we just have this very, very simple formula here. And then the right one is just going to be, sorry, it's going to be negative x on the left one. And then positive x on the right one. And then we have our two vectors. And so, let's see. So our up vector here, the top of this one can also be simplified now as well. Instead of doing up multiplied by height, we can just do new vector 3, 0, height 0. Save some operations. It's cheaper too. And then here we're drawing a wire disk. That's just vector3.up for our normal for this one. Because again, the normal is now in local space, and that's just the, you know, 0, 1, 0. So now we don't even need these variables anymore. We can just delete those. And so I think this code, it's a lot easier to wrap your head around. It's so much cleaner because we're doing everything in local space now instead of doing it in world space. So if we compare it to this code has had a lot of like variables we're caching. We're adding origin up, right, and forward everywhere. These lines are kind of hard to read, and it's just kind of messy, right? And so that's kind of the beauty of doing things in local space, and the beauty of using matrices, because now we've just simplified all of this drawing. Although we also need to make sure that it works. Maybe I broke something. Let's just try it out. I did break something. Okay, so the origin of the disks don't work. And the reason for this is because gizmos and handles use separate matrices. And so we're only setting the gizmo matrix, but we can also set the handles matrix. And so now we're setting both of them to the local to world matrix of our transform. So going back, recompile, and there we go. So now if we rotate this one, everything works. Even though we're supplying local space coordinates, everything works. So that is a very useful thing to keep in mind, that quite often when you're doing math, doing it in the right space can actually save you a lot of performance. Because sometimes you notice that you keep doing a lot of vector math and like adding and projecting and all of that, when sometimes you can just use components in local space for all of the things you wanted to do. So this code is actually much cheaper as well. It runs much faster than this code does here. Now we're just using this for debug drawing, but there's quite a lot of situations where you're doing similar math like this, but in real time in your game. Did that make sense? Like what just happened here? I'm gonna go prepare my tea while I wait for stream delay. I forgot my mug. I need my mug. Okay. All right. No questions about this. Clear. Good. For me, it gets all twisted when I rotate it. Then something is getting mixed up somewhere. And I don't know what could be wrong. It's possible that it's very easy to accidentally use mixed values. Like if you're doing the dot product between a local space vector and a world space vector, you're gonna get weird results. Weird, incorrect things will happen. So quite often when you get those types of weird, just you move something and something else moves in a different direction, or you rotate something and something else is just pivoting off of somewhere else, usually you're mixing up local coordinates and world coordinates somewhere. So I would double check that, like make sure all of your math is done in the same space. I think that would be the first thing I would check. Okay. All right. So, so far we've just been doing the drawing itself. We haven't done any of the like actual trigger itself. We've just been very helpfully making gizmos so that whoever is sitting and doing level design or whatever can see what's going on, which is very good. Crucial thing in tool development, which is something I spend a lot of time on. All right, so we have our angular threshold, we have our pi, it's in local space, everything is great, except the fact that it doesn't work. We actually, it doesn't do anything, it just looks pretty. So the next step is to do the math to actually detect whether or not something is inside or outside. All right, so we're gonna assign our target in the wedge trigger, because we're just gonna hard code a single target. We're not going to write a whole targeting system. Okay. So now we need to make a function to check. I'll just delete this code. We need a function to check if something is inside of this trigger or not. So I'm just going to call that contains, bool contains. Oh, you got it working. Nice. Okay, we're gonna check if it contains some position or some target. I don't know what to call this one. Target's probably fine. Or wait, we're using that name here. Let's do position. Is 180 degrees the limit? I think it should be possible to go all the way to negative one. I'm not sure if my math has support for that. Maybe. I can try. Change the slider. Yep. So if you want one that is greater than... greater than 180 degrees, you can do that, but it's kind of ambiguous which side it's on. but in my case, I don't want it to ever go behind itself, so. Okay. So now we need to do the checks to see if it's inside or outside. And like I mentioned before, we basically have three different things that we're checking. We're checking a cylindrical radial check. We also have a height check. That's kind of the top and bottom planes that we're checking that were within that interval. And then we have an angular check. And so these are kind of the three conditions that have to be met in order for us to be inside or outside this thing. Okay. And so I guess first we can just make a temporary function to make sure that it works. So maybe we can do vector3.distance between position and transform.position. And if that's less than radius. So now this is just a spherical trigger. So just doing this temporarily, just because I want to set up the coloring so that we can color the gizmos. So let's set the colors. We're also going to set the handle color. So contains target.position. And if it does, we want to use color.white. Otherwise, color.red. Okay. Let's try that. So now it should be a spherical trigger, which is incorrect, but just to make sure we get the coloring working. Okay, neat. That seems to be working. But now we need to make sure that it actually does the correct check here. All right. So, one part of this assignment was that I wanted you to do this in, to make sure that you can still move this around and do all of this in, so that you can rotate the trigger and all of the checks should still work the way you intended. And again, this is a use case where if you do things in local space, all of this is going to be much, much easier. If you do this in world space, there's a lot of like projection and vector math that you have to do that is kind of annoying. And so one of the first things you're going to want to do to make this simple is to transform the direction to the target into local space. So instead of doing this in world space, if we just know the direction to the target in the local space of this transform, all of this is going to become much, much simpler. So let's do that. So first we need the direction to the target, right? Direction to your target. So that is going to be the position is the target, and then transform.position is the origin. This is kind of the vector from this object to the target. But we're also going to want to normalize that. Otherwise, it's just a difference vector or a displacement rather than a direction that's usually normalized. But this is in world space. But we want this in local space. So direction to target. Like I mentioned before, Unity has built-in functions for this. And this type of transformation is basically doing the matrix multiplication we talked about earlier. So we want to convert this to local space, and we do that using transform dot inverse transform direction. You could also use inverse transform vector. The difference between those two is just how it handles scale. But we don't have any scaled objects right now. So in this case, we can just use inverse transform vector. So in here, we just pass in our world space coordinate, and we're going to convert that to local space, because inverse transform is world to local. Okay. So now we have the direction in local space. And that is wonderful. Actually, we're going to need the full vector, so let's not normalize this. And this is going to be the vector to target. And then we can have the direction separately. Okay, these are the things we're going to need. So let's start with the easiest one. So that's going to be the height position check. So if we have the location of the target here in local space, then if it's below zero, it's outside on the y-axis. And if the y-coordinate is above our height value, it's also outside, right? And so all we really need to do the height check is to check the y component of our target in the local space coordinates. And so that's all we need to do to check the height. In other words, if the vector to target dot y is less than zero, or if the vector to target dot y is greater than height, then we return. Oh, we return false because it's outside, right? Okay, so if it's outside that, it is not inside. So we can just early out this function. We don't need to run all of the calculations. We can just skip the rest, because if it's outside the height range, it's never going to be inside this anyway. Okay, so let's test this. Okay, so this one, remember that we're just checking the height range now. We're not checking anything else. So we can see that it's outside here, inside, outside, inside, outside. It seems to be checking that height interval, right? The infinite stretches of planes. It's checking if it's inside or outside those two infinite planes. So that seems to be working. Even though it's rotated and all of that. All right. Okay, so you can see that if we did this in with world space coordinates instead, then this would look a little bit different, right? Then that would involve like using the dot product of like we would take the I guess this should be renamed now. Because this is the vector to the target, right? So if we wanted to do this in world space, this would get like a lot more complicated. It would be like we would have to do the dot product. We would do transform or vector 3 dot dot transform dot up between that vector. So then we would get the projected distance onto that vector using our relative vector there. And then we would check, then we would do the range check using this value instead of vector target dot y. So instead of just reading a single component, we would have to calculate this using the dot product, which is more expensive than simply just using the y component, right? Okay, I'm gonna go get my tea. Type some questions if you have questions. Not working for some reason. Did I mistype something? Yes, your transform is using inverse transform point, but you have to use inverse transform vector. Because again, we're transforming a relative vector. We're not transforming a position. Because this is a relative vector, right? And then we want to transform that from world space to local space. It is possible to do this kind of the other way around. If we transform the position to local space before we do the subtraction, then we can use inverse transform points. I thought it was inverse transform direction. Either would work if it's normalized. I think transform direction is a bit of a special case. I forget exactly what it does. I never use it because I feel like it like secretly normalizes stuff, but maybe we can see what it does. Or maybe it's internal. Okay, yeah, it's internal. Yeah, I don't use it because I feel like it's secretly calling normalize. I'm not sure if it does. And I forget how it deals with scale. This operation is unaffected by scale. Yeah, this is world to local, unaffected by scale. Okay, I don't know if it normalizes. It's a little unclear. I feel like it should normalize if it's called direction, but I don't know. I don't use it, and so yeah. I think vector takes in scale as a factor. Yes. Yeah, so I think if you pass in a... The question for me is, what happens if I pass in a non-normalized vector? Will this normalize it or will it not? It's a little unclear. I don't know which one it does. But generally, whenever I transform vectors, I almost never have scaled spaces. So for me, I just pretty much always use inverse transform vector or point, right? Okay, I should probably, hold on, I just need to pin a message because a lot of people are asking about that. Okay. Okay. All right. Next one. Let's see, which one do we do? Let's do the wedge, because that one is actually very simple. So we want to do the angular check, right? But if we go back here, remember that if we have the direction to our object, then this length right here directly relates to our threshold value, right? And so if we have this direction, we can simply check the, in this case, the Z component to see if it's above or below our threshold. And so we have direction to target here. I guess maybe we should move it down. So then all we need to do to check our threshold is if direction to target dot Z, because that is the that's the forward direction of our trigger. So the blue one is the Z axis and that's forward. So we just need to check if this one, if that one is less than our angular threshold, then we return false, because then it's outside the angular wedge. So we can comment out the height position check so we can test this one in isolation. Okay. So that one is inside and then outside. Inside, outside. Not sure if this doesn't look like it actually works. Something's wrong. Something's wrong. Yes. Okay. So one of the things that we need to keep in mind every time we normalize vectors like this, and when we're working with spaces that are not radial, because remember that this one is actually a cylinder, we're not working with spheres, right? And so when we check for this one, we actually need the normalized flattened vector, because if it's pointing upwards in some sort of direction, it's going to start creating the shape of a sphere, right? Not a cylinder. And so when we normalize the 3D vector, it's going to become a little bit shorter up here. So I suspect that in our case, it's going to work if it's all the way down here, like near the bottom plane. So here, it seems to work fine, right? So inside, outside, inside, outside. But as soon as we move it upwards, now it no longer works because we're doing we're basically normalizing in the sphere. So we're going to have to do a little bit of shenanigans here, where we're going to need to flatten this one. So we actually want we want the direction flattened on the xz plane. Okay, so let's do flat direction to target. So we're going to set that to initially set that to the vector to the target. And then we do flat direction to target dot y equals 0. So we flatten it so that it's along the floor of this one. And then we normalize it. And then we can check that component. Okay, so recompile, see if this works. So now it counts as inside. So that's good because we're doing the infinite wedge right now. We're not doing the, it's not getting clamped by the height. So now it seems like our inside outside test is actually working. So it's inside, should be inside over here too, because it's an infinite wedge. So it's only along this plane that you can see that it's changing from inside to outside, right? Same thing with this plane right here. Okay. Did that make sense? It's a little bit funky because we're flattening vectors and doing, we're effectively flattening this to 2D here, except we're still using a vector 3. We could use a vector 2 if we want to, and that would be a little bit cheaper as well because normalized would be not doing an unnecessary addition and cubing, but yeah, did that make sense? People are typing. I didn't get how checking the Z counts as checking the angular threshold. Because our angular threshold is determined by setting this value, right? Like we decide what result of the dot product should be our threshold. And then we have the forward direction and the direction to our target. And so all we need to check our angular threshold is this value right here. And the reason that the Z component corresponds to this value is because what it's really doing, this value is the projected distance onto the Z axis, right? So the Z axis, this distance right here, is this value. And so once we convert it to local space, it actually just so happens that the Z value of this coordinate is the dot product, because that is kind of how, like every component of a vector is the dot product against each basis vector. So that's why our projected distance directly corresponds to the Z coordinate in our in this context right here, because this is the value, this is the Z coordinate, and that is also the projected value onto that vector. And that's why. So we have the x-axis here and the z-axis here, and the y-axis is pointing toward us here. Yeah. Hope that made sense. All right. And so we have the height precision check. We have the angular wedge. Okay, finally, we need to check if the if we're outside of the cylinder. So now we're doing the height check. We're doing the wedge, so we can test the height. We can be inside or outside here, and we can be inside or outside the wedge. But it still counts as inside if we're over over here, right? And that's incorrect. Like this should not count as inside. So the distance test is not working as is. So we need to do that. And again, here we need to be careful to use the flattened or the two-dimensional distance to make sure that it becomes a cylinder. If we don't do that, we're actually going to be testing a sphere, like a cutoff sphere. That would give us a little bit of extra distance. Again, none of these are like either correct or wrong. It just depends on how you want to design your turret. So maybe your turret is just supposed to work like that. So again, it kind of depends on like what type of trigger you want to make. But if we want to make this type of wedge, like a cylindrical cutoff, then we need to use a cylindrical check, which means that we're doing a we don't really use a 3D like spherical distance test, we're just testing the flattened 2D vector, and that turns it into a cylinder. So we're gonna make use of this flat direction again, but we kind of need the distance now. We don't actually know the length of this one, so we need to know how far away is the target along this flattened vector. So we need to calculate that. We're gonna do that here. So this is kind of the flat distance. Let's just call it that. And that is going to be flat direction to target dot magnitude. And here we can actually do a tiny little bit of an optimization. So here we are normalizing the flattened vector here, right? But now we're actually calculating the distance twice. And we're calculating the distance here, and we are calculating it in here in order to normalize it. So we could actually do a tiny bit of optimization by normalizing it manually. We just divide it by its distance, or its length in this case. And then we get the normalized vector. Wait, why is this sad? Oh, convert to compound assignments. Well, I mean, I guess. So this will actually normalize. Okay, so now we've done a tiny, tiny optimization. Isn't that cute? So now we have the distance, and now we can check for that too. So if flat distance I guess we can just return directly here, but we should keep the same structure. So if flat distance is greater than the radius, then we return false. So this means we're outside the infinite cylinder. Okay. And if we pass all of these tests, we're inside. All right, and that should do it. I believe that is all we need to check this wedge. Let's make sure it works, just to make sure I'm not lying to you. Okay, so now it's outside the whole thing, and it's inside. And there we go. And that seems to work. And we can change some properties in this one. We can change the threshold to be way more narrow. Wait. Really? What the fuck? How did I manage to place the target exactly so that if I set this to 1, it counts as inside? I thought this would be like floating point mathematically impossible to do. Anyway, sorry. So we're testing the wedge. It seems to work fine, right? Okay. Then we can change the radius. So now it's outside, inside, can change the height, outside, inside. Seems to work. All right, we did it. We made the radial trigger, or our cheese wedge trigger. Okay, any questions about this? Something is wrong for me. Okay, let's go back to code. How'd you draw the wire disk? That is handles.drawWireDisk. Your first line should not normalize. So this line right here, don't normalize this one. Because this is just the relative vector. It's not the direction in this case. I think that's what's wrong with your code. Everything else looks good. All right. I don't know how time passes so quickly. It's actually insane. Apparently we're up on our next break already. I don't get it. All right. Any other questions about our trigger? Did you fix the inside when angle says F1? I'm not sure if it's always when it's F1, or it might actually be the case. Like, am I just placing the target exactly? Like, this should be extremely hard. Like, as you can see, I'm not hitting inside. Oh wait, there we go. Found it. I probably wouldn't spend time to fix this because I don't know what the use case is for a turret with a completely flat vision. Lots of typing. Could use as a laser grid. You would probably make a different type of trigger then. Like using this for that would be strange. Like if you want to do a laser grid, it would be sort of like checking the distance to a plane, and if that plane is less than something, right? So it'd be more like a planar trigger or just a box trigger. In an actual implementation of something like this, would it use a box shape collision? If you mean the completely flattened version, yes. Usually if you want to make like a planar trigger, you generally use boxes because boxes are fast. It's very, very cheap to use boxes for testing. okay. Let's do another 10-minute break. We're resuming. Resuming at 11:10. Okay, cool. Oh, by the way, Am I going too fast? Am I going too slow? Am I not showing the code enough? Am I going on too many tangents? I'm not sure what you think about the pacing, if I'm completely off or if it's okay. It's also kind of hard because sometimes different students require different pacing. But I do want to try to keep it open so you can like ask questions at any time and just let me know if something feels off or unclear. Too perfectly paced. Aw, thanks. You're getting top grades. You did. Because that was a compliment. Good pacing. The concepts are just hard to grasp. Yeah. The thing is that, like, we are basically speedrunning a shitload of math that you do for several years in school. And so it is kind of hard to grasp all of this. And, like, it's easier for me to do this because I've been doing this for so long now. But if, like, if you have never heard of the dot product and you're just learning about it now, then I can imagine it's pretty fast-paced, right? But I think there's a lot of value in having, like, actual use cases for these concepts where, like, I imagine, like, when I learned about the dot product in school, I don't even remember learning about it. That's how much I've forgotten. I just completely dropped that out of my mind because I didn't know what the point was, right? But I'm hoping that if there's a context, it's easier to remember because now it's like, oh, the dot product is actually a useful tool, right? And then I'm giving you this tool that I'm hoping is useful. The dot product has eluded me until now. Oh, neat. This math dude we had at my last job said it gives a magnitude. That is very misleading. Oh, someone in YouTube chat. Can you reflect rays with the dot product? Yes, that was the second assignment. That was one of the first assignments after learning about the dot product. I think I put a link to the assignments in the description. If not, I can share them with you. That's not the share button. I think I put this link in the description of the YouTube video. So there you go. That's a link to all the lectures and all of the assignments. So there you go. Second assignment was to make a bouncing laser. Are you worked at a place where you're making educational interactive stuff and they got the dot product wrong? Fascinating. I guess if it's not, like, math education, it might be fine. If it's, like, I don't know, educational content for, like, biology or whatever, then maybe you don't have to know about the dot product. But if it's math, then it's a little bit suspicious. Was for grade 10? I don't know how it is in Sweden. Yeah, I forget. This lecture is going on for another hour. We're currently on break. So we're going to go in 5 minutes. We're going to do 50 minutes of going through the assignments. And then after lunch, we are going to look into trigonometry. So trigonometry is starting in 2 hours. Yeah, trigonometry class in 2 hours. That's the plan. I'm going to cut the stream during lunch, so it's going to be a separate link. So be sure to like, comment, and subscribe, and hit the bell and all of that if you want to catch the next thing. Or just set an alarm in 2 hours from now. Okay. What was your specialization during college? I never went to college. And so, I don't know. I did go to FutureGames though. So it's a like short vocational school that was like 2 years long. Specifically for, I went there for game design. I don't do a whole lot of game design these days, but yeah. Otherwise I'm educated just to high school. So you're a self-taught developer. I feel like the word self-taught is a little bit misleading because the thing is you learn a lot when you're at a workplace. And I feel like I've learned most of my stuff from, well, both from hobby projects, but also just from being at a workplace and doing work. Like, you learn so much when you're at an actual, in an actual project where you actually have to ship a product and go from A to B, right? So to some extent, yes, I guess I'm self-taught, but I learned a lot just through work and not just like, yeah, it's not like I've been doing all of this on my own. Are you from the UK? No, I'm not from the UK. I would have expected my accent to, like, my accent is not very, you know, UK, but sure. Okay. More tutorials, less playing games? What? Buddy, I can do whatever I want on my YouTube channel. And if I want to play D&D with my friends and put videos about that on my YouTube channel, I'm going to do that because I really enjoy that. I am not someone who's just going to do whatever you tell me to do. Preby. What a YouTube chatter. Classic YouTube chatter. Have you ever worked on Unreal? Yes, I have worked in Unreal. Mostly in Unreal Engine 3. I've done some work in 4, but mostly in 3. Are you mainly C# and Java developer? I used to do Java a long time ago. These days I mostly do C# and HLSL. Most of what I do is in Unity, and I do mostly tool development and shader stuff, and a little bit of gameplay programming as well, depending on what I'm doing, and depending on the current project. So a lot of C#, a lot of HLSL. Yeah, that's kind of what I focus on. Sometimes when I have to, if I'm doing like online stuff, I obviously have to use HTML, JavaScript, PHP. I usually just do vanilla JS, for better or for worse. I'm uncomfortable with modern web dev, so. Modern web dev seems scary. I don't want to have to install 50 frameworks, and I don't know. So I just do vanilla. Draw furry art on stream just to piss people off. I did that a while back. I really need to get back into art. I really want to. Yeah, I think after my lectures at FutureGames and after I've released my spline video that I've been working on for a year. Oh God. I think I need to take a break because I've been, like, it's been a struggle because I got burnt out in the middle of the year. And so I think I need to step back from the type of work that I'm doing right now, like coding, I guess. So I think I'm probably going to try to force myself not to do this type of work, after my spline video is done and after my lectures. I think I'm going to try to just do more art. I want to do more art and I want to get better at it. And it's something I really enjoy. And so I think that's what I'm going to do in a few months, I suppose. I hope you'll stream that. If I do, I'm going to stream it on Twitch, because Twitch has much more lax music copyright policies. Streaming on YouTube is a nightmare because I'm going to get like copyright stricken immediately. Okay, all right. I think we should resume. I think the break is over. Okay. All right. Okay. Wait, why do you react with Internet Explorer? Of all of the emotes you can react with. I don't understand. But you know, that's fine. You can react with Internet Explorer. Reacted with your cat. Good. Okay. Cool. Let's resume. What even was the last assignment? Okay, turret alignment, that we've done. And then we had the turret trigger, that's what we were doing now. We did the drawing too. And we set the view cone. All of that stuff we did. All right, so the last thing before we go for lunch is the turret look and fire. So now we basically want to implement this. We want to put this on the turret itself so that the turrets can detect something that is inside. And then we want to rotate the our turret so that it's pointing toward the target. All right. So that's what we're going to do. So now we've just created this wedge trigger, but the trigger itself is kind of just entirely separate from our turret. So we're gonna just nuke that trigger, or we can just move it, I suppose. So let's bring back the little turret, and then we need some lights and geometry. Let's move this around a bit. Some neat terrain. This is what terrain looks like. Maybe we need a flat surface just for fun. Cube. Why not? Beautiful rolling hills. It's great. Okay, so now we need to put the wedge trigger on our turret. So now we have this turret placement code. We still have that. That's kind of working the way we would expect. Here we go. Let's also remove some of these debug lines just to make it a little bit more readable. So that was in the turret placer. We don't want to draw these anymore. Just delete some code. Okay. I'm going to turn off the grid. Neat. Do I delete this line too? Let's just make it a little bit more transparent. There we go. In case you don't know, the fourth component in color is the opacity. If you're using like an alpha blended shader, which by default Unity does. So this will set the opacity. Usually called the alpha channel. There we go. Now the line is a little bit more faint. Okay, cool. We have a turret, and now we need to add the trigger. So we're going to move the wedge trigger into the turret. So I'm just going to move it and set the local position to 0, set the local rotation to 0. So now we have our little wedge trigger. So now I want to adapt this for this turret. Probably want this turret to have a bit of a longer range. So we're going to increase the radius. And I'm also going to increase the height, because now we can basically only point forward and downwards. But I feel like it should be able to have a bit of a upwards tilt as well. Yeah, something like that, maybe. Maybe that's good. So now we can also test this. Move the target around to make sure that it works. And it does. We are passing through all of the thresholds that we've been using to check. And it will detect. Okay. So now the goal is for the turret to point at the target. If you set the wedge on the turret, won't it still be offset due to the defaults where you draw the line? What do you mean by offset? Yellow is a turret. I'm not sure why there would be an offset. It looks fine in my case. I've set the wedge trigger as a child object. Okay, you got it. Okay, cool. All right. So we have our wedge trigger, and we can detect if it's inside or outside. And now the goal is to make the turret point at this target if it's inside, right? And I've set up the prefab that I have here. I've set it up so that the gun itself is a kind of a separate thing. And so what we're going to do is that we're going to rotate the gun of the turret to point at the location. So we're going to set the rotation of this object specifically. Probably not going to rotate around this axis, but so that's going to be our goal. We want this one to point at the target. All right, so we're probably going to want a script on our turret, because we actually don't have that right now. Right now we just have a script on the camera that's placing the turret and the wedge trigger itself. So we're going to make a script called just turret, I suppose. Okay. So we're going to need a reference to our trigger, because we want to be able to call functions in that. We want to be able to call, trigger.contains. That's the function we're going to need. Um, So we're going to put the wedge trigger here. Trigger. And then we're going to need the target, right? Because we're just going to hard code the target. We're just going to be lazy and do this in onDraw gizmos. Generally, this is like you would put this in update or something, but we're just doing it in onDraw gizmos because it's easy. We don't have to press play. Makes life easier. All right. So we should probably track those references. And right, we also need the transform that represents the gun itself, right? So we need this transform here. So we're going to need a transform. That's the gun transform. Personally, I usually use TF to mean transform to make it a little bit more... it's a little bit annoying when you have like really long words in your variable names. At least I think so. So I usually just use TF for transforms. And the reason for this is that you might have a script at some point that's attached to the gun that's just called gun. And then I would rather just call that gun, but if it's specifically the transform, I usually just add TF just to clarify that. Okay, so now I think we have all we need. Just need to drag those references in Unity to assign them all. Okay, so we have the wedge trigger, and then we have our target, and then we have the gun transform. So now we've assigned all of those to our turrets, and now we're ready to do something with this. Okay. So now all we need to do is to check if it's inside, and if it is, we set the rotation of the gun. So let's do that. So if trigger dot contains target dot position, then we want to do something, right? We want to set the rotation of the gun. So we're going to do gun transform dot rotation. And we've used this one before. I haven't really explained how quaternions work, but you also don't really have to know. So we've been using quaternion, quaternion dot look rotation. And so basically look rotation allows you to pass in a forward direction and an upwards direction, and it's going to just construct a rotation for you. We wanted to point directly at the target, right? So we need that vector. So direction to target, that's going to be our forward. That is going to be, that's going to be the vector from the gun to our target. So that's going to be target.position minus gun.position. And this is, again, this is now in world space. Direction to target is world space. And dot rotation is also the world space rotation. If you do dot local rotation, you would set the local space rotation. So in this case, we're explicitly setting the world space rotation. All right, so the look rotation, we want that to point in the direction of the target. And this is not really a direction in this case. I guess it's the vector to target. Because again, this is not normalized, but look rotation doesn't require you to normalize them. It kind of automatically handles that. And so I think if you normalize this, look rotation is probably going to do another unnecessary normalization. Just a thing to keep in mind. All right, and then we need an up direction. And the up direction should just be the same as the turret base. It should not be, sorry. But we can start with this. We can start with that. It's a good starting point. So this is going to be... we're just going to do transform.up. We can do the pitch later. Also, thank you for the donation, person in YouTube chat. The YouTube chat that I'm not reading while I'm doing these lectures. Okay. If it's not inside, Then we kind of have to decide, like, what do we want to do when it's not inside? And here we can, like, we have a few options. This is going to come down to, like, your game design. Like, do we want it to reset to point forwards? Or do we want it to reset to... do you want it to reset or maybe it should just stay still, right? Like, it targets something, and then when it's out of range, it just stays there. So it's kind of a design question. Right now, if we do nothing, it's just going to stay, because we're not setting it when the target is outside. And that's kind of up to you. I think for this one, we probably just want it to... it actually works to set it this way. So now we're setting the target. I was a little bit worried the pitch wouldn't work, but it actually does work. And that's because the look rotation actually does a few cross products to do a lot of this for us. And so it's working in this case. Seems to be fine. We got our turret. It's pointing at the target. And as soon as we go outside, it stops pointing at it. We can move a little bit over here. Move into the view and boop. And there we go. So what's happening here is that quaternion.lookRotation allows you to pass in vectors that are not orthogonal to each other. And so this one will actually just use this as an alignment hint, but it's going to prioritize this one. How to get rotation on a certain axis. We haven't talked a whole lot about rotations, but you can do quaternion.euler. And here you have your regular Euler angles in degrees. So if you want to construct a rotation from Euler angles, you can do that like this. But we're going to get into rotations after lunch. Whenever I create a, hold on. How'd you get the turret to rotate around the sphere? Whenever I create a thing sticking out of it like a barrel, the pivot point will kind of move to the middle of the whole thing. It sounds like you have your pivot point set to center rather than pivot, I'm guessing. Like in this case, the gun is a parent object and all of the models are just child objects. So the gun itself is its own transform. Can't we do it through vectors and quaternions though? Yeah, you could, but I'm not sure how you would define that rotation if not through angles. So it depends on like what do you mean by get rotation in that case. In my implementation, I had a separate yaw rotator and a separate pitch rotator. You can do that too, yeah. But then we haven't talked about compositing rotations, and so that's why I'm not doing that now. Out of curiosity, how would you go about removing the rest of the circle and only keep the wedge visible? Then we're going to need to get into angles, and that's what we're going to do after lunch. I can give you the answer now if you want to, but that's spoilers. Do you really want spoilers? So then that seems to work. We did it. What a turret. Maybe move it around a bit. You can see that the turret is still pointing at the target. Even if we're placing it on uneven terrain, which we should also test, that's important. And that seems to be fine. Even if it's rotated, our turret is happily pointing at the target. Okay. Not sure what I did wrong, but the arc is on the wrong rotation compared to the turret. That sounds like it's a mix-up of local space and world space, and so I'm guessing something about your drawing. Let's see, where's our trigger? So first off, if you're doing it in world space or local space, make sure that if you're doing local space calculation, make sure that you set the drawing matrix to a local space. It's possible that maybe you only have gizmo stop matrix, but not handle stop matrix. So maybe that's why the arcs are wrong, but maybe the rest is correct. I would guess. Was child rotation? Nice. Okay. Hate it when children rotate. It's like, ah, oh, jeez. Rotated children. All right. Any questions about this? Destroy child? Yeah, that's a classic. Like in many projects, I've had to write a function that's just called destroy all children. And it's like, damn, really went there. What a turret. Okay, no questions. Everything's good. Yours is going crazy. What could that be? I guess it depends on how it's going crazy. So one thing that I did here is that keep in mind that the setting the rotation of the turret, this is a separate object from the base of the turret. So the base is a separate entity. And so when you rotate the turret of the gun, or the gun of the turret, then make sure that you don't rotate the base, the parent object. You only want to rotate the barrel of the turret. Just realized rotator is a palindrome? Damn, I did not know that. That is really neat. Okay, I think we're good on this. Should we do the last two as well? Like adding the laser and the bonus assignment to add smoothing to the turret? Do you want to see those two, or what do you think? We have 25 minutes until lunch. Just the bonus part. If I move my target inside of the target area in a circular motion for long enough, it slowly rotates on the z-axis. So that will probably happen when you're setting the rotation of this object. If you're using, so here I'm using transform.up, which is the up vector of the base of the turret. But if you instead use the gun transforms up vector, I think that's what's going to happen. I think that's when you get that type of drifting. We can test it. That's what my intuition is telling me, at least. Yeah, there you go. So now if we do the circular motion, you can see that the turret is now tilting. So now we have this Z tilt. So that's probably what you did. You probably used the the guns up vector instead of the base plate up vector. Because I have this script is attached to the base and not the like rotating gun. Okay, so should we do the smoothing, or what do we? I guess maybe attaching the laser is not super fascinating. It's just setting it to that position. What do you think, laser? Before we go for lunch, or sorry, smoothing. Smoothing. Smoothie. Okay. Let's keep it smooth. This is gonna make me sad though, because now we need to factor in something called time. I don't know if you heard about time, but it's something that happens when you press play. And so unfortunately, we're gonna have to move some code around. But that's okay, I suppose. All right. Okay, all right. Can't we lerp it in Androgismus though? Spoilers, jeez. Using the L word. Goodness. You could, but the problem is that, so Androgismus does not happen every frame. And the concept of frames in the editor is actually kind of dubious, because the scene view doesn't actually get called every frame. It only gets called when something changes. So if you move something, it repaints. But if you don't do anything, it's not gonna call. And so it's nothing's gonna change. The one exception is if you there's a setting something for somewhere for animated materials, I think. I always forget where it is. Oh, here. So there's a setting here called always refresh. If you check this one, it will draw and repaint the scene every frame. But by default, this is unchecked. So it's a little bit spicy to do that in Androgismus. Because then we also don't have access to like time dot delta time. And so for this one, I'm probably going to want to do it in update. Okay. We're changing this to update. Okay. Smoothing for this one is actually going to go through a few things that we haven't really done these things, and that's because it's a bonus assignment, because we're going to have to use concepts that I haven't talked about in the lectures. but so basically what we want to do is we want to add some sort of smoothing so that it doesn't just immediately snap to the target, and so that when it finds a target, we want it to smoothly like rotate to face that target, right? And doing that type of smooth motion, you can do that in many different ways. By far, the most popular way to do this type of smoothing is basically misusing lerp in order to get a smooth motion. We're going to talk about lerp eventually in this class. Probably won't have time for it today in general, but let's briefly mention it. So when we want to interpolate between some values, let's say we have a value of A here, and then we have another value of B, then we can quite often blend between these two, right? So maybe we want to find a value that's halfway between these, like at 0.5. So what LERP allows us to do is to blend between two different things linearly. And that's what the L stands for. It stands for linear interpolation. So LERP takes three values. It has A, it has B, which is the start value and the end value, and then a percentage. So 0.5 would give you the value that's halfway between. If you give it the value of 0, it's going to just return A. If you give it a value of 1, it's just going to return B. And any values in between are going to be a blend. So 0.75 is going to be whatever blend you have here. And A and B can be a lot of different types. So maybe A and B are numbers. So maybe we're blending between -3 and 6. And then this is going to blend between these two numbers. So it's going to get the numbers in between based off of the percentage here. And these percentages are usually called t values. That's usually what this third parameter is called. Okay, so that's what LERP is. LERP smoothing is kind of a way to abuse this function. It's kind of a hack. So if you want to LERP from A to B, let's say that that's our thing. And we say that we want to go, I guess 0.5 is easy. So 0.5, we want to go halfway between A and B. So if we call this function, but instead of just calling it, we're going to assign that to A. So what's going to happen when we call this function is that A is going to basically move to the middle. So A is now going to be here. So now this is A. The next time around we run this function, the interval has changed. So now it's this range we're working with. So if we call it again, A is going to be halfway between A and B here. And then we call it again, and then it's going to be halfway between A and B here. And then we call it again, it's going to be halfway, call it again, it's going to be halfway. And as you can see, it kind of slows down here, right? It's just going to do halfway, 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 halfway. And so you can see that it's fast in the beginning. After just one frame, we go halfway all the way between these. But then we make a shorter skip, and then an even shorter skip, and then an even shorter skip, and then it just shortens until infinity like that. Yeah, basically Zeno's paradox. And so this type of thing is a hack called LERP smoothing. Incidentally, this is the concept that Jonathan Blow blocked me on Twitter for. So that's some important trivia to remember. So this is LERP smoothing. So LERP smoothing is very easy to implement because smoothing can be kind of complicated in general. And so this is just a very straightforward way of doing it, and it just kind of works. But there are a few problems. We're going to talk a little bit about frame rate independence later. But keep in mind what this function is saying. Because if we're doing this in an update loop is run every frame, right? It's not run every second. And so what's happening is that if you do this every frame, this equation is basically saying, go halfway to B every frame. And so imagine what happens if you have a different frame rate. If you're running the game at like 30 FPS, then it's going to move much slower than if you're running this at like 300 FPS, right? So this function is not frame rate independent. it's generally kind of complicated to do this. And you can sort of approximate it. You can approximate it by scaling this value by time dot delta time. That is an incorrect way to do it, but it actually works kind of well in a lot of cases, but you might have to change this value to something else. So this is mathematically incorrect, but it works if you find a good value for it. So in most cases, you get sort of an okay smoothing here. And quite often, the type of smoothing, like quite often you use lerp smoothing for things that are not gameplay related. So it could be something like you're smoothing a UI element. You're moving some sort of object in the UI. Maybe it's something following a cursor, like whatever. Then it doesn't really matter if it's slightly faster or slower, depending on frame rates. But if it's very crucial to gameplay, then you might want to do a proper way and not do this hack. Okay. All right. So this is lerp smoothing. And so we get the smoothing motion by doing this effectively. Okay. And so the challenge now is that we need A and B. And A is going to be the current rotation of the turrets. And B is going to be the rotation that we want when it's facing the target, right? So this is going to be the target rotation. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to update the current rotation to kind of partially blend toward the target rotation. And when you're using a lerp function, sometimes you use specific lerp functions for different types. So if we're interpolating something that is either a normalized vector or if we're interpolating rotations, usually that has a different name. Usually that's called slurp, which is a very funny name. So that is basically just short for spherical lerp. So the function we're going to want to use is slurp. And then we need to kind of decide. We can either slurp the direction from the current one to the target, or we can slurp the rotations directly. Either will work fine. That's what we need to do. And let's implement that. So we've already moved this to update, so that's good. We're going to get our target rotation. What's the difference between lerp and slurp? Slurp is just a name we use when we're doing spherical interpolation. There's a minor difference for like vectors. So if we have two direction vectors, let's say this one, and this one, lerp will blend linearly and slurp will blend spherically. So this is slurp and this is lerp. So slurp will basically blend like this. You get these vectors when you blend between them, and lerp will blend like this. So for vectors, slurp and lerp work differently. So it lerps both direction and magnitude separately, basically, yeah. Slurp is also the word used when interpolating rotations. So if you're using this for quaternions, you would call it slurp. What? Sorry for zooming so much. So target rotation. Again, rotations are usually stored in a data type called a quaternion. We're going to talk about that more later. So this is our target rotation. So what we want to do is then blend between the current rotation and the target rotation. So we're going to use quaternion dot slurp. And we want to slurp between the current rotation and the target rotation. And then we need a factor. We need some sort of smoothing factor. Again, 0.5 means that it's going to go halfway between the current rotation and the target rotation every frame. So we might want to be able to tweak this. So I'm just going to make that a public float. Smoothing factor. Let's just set it to 1 by default. So we're going to add the smoothing factor here. And we're going to multiply that by time dot delta time. Because then we get an approximation of a frame rate independent smoothing factor. But it's only an approximation. It's not actually accurate. And that's why Jonathan Blow blocked me on Twitter, because I said it's fine and he said it's not fine. And he got very angry. Anyway, so that's our smoothing factor, and this should work. Unless I missed something. Let's see if it works. A slurp also never reached the target rotation. Yeah, it works exactly the same way. Technically, usually they do reach the target location eventually, depending on the smoothing factor, because of floating point imprecision. But mathematically, they never reach the target. No. And so there we go. We have a very soft turret. This might be a little bit too slow. I don't know about you, but this seems a little bit too goopy. So maybe we should change the smoothing factor a little bit. That's still a little slow. Maybe we want to set it to 10. That's looking a little bit better. So there we go. Now we have a smooth looking turret. Even if it's instantaneously changing, then there we go. Could this be used to code the rotation of tank turrets, for example? Yeah, that's basically what we've done here, right? This might as well be a tank. Just put some tank treads on it, and now it's a tank. All right. Don't have a whole lot of time left. We could polish this. There are a few bugs or things that look bad. Like if we set it to... If we move it outside, it kind of loses momentum, right? Or that looks pretty weird. So we'd probably want to adjust for that if we want to polish this. Right, the code. Here's the code. If 0.5 is halfway to the target rotation, shouldn't 1 be 100% of the target rotation? Instant snapping. Yes. If you set the smoothing factor, if you don't have time delta time, a smoothing factor is 1, it's going to instantaneously be set to target rotation. Similarly, if this is 0, it's never even going to move off of its current rotation. Yeah. All right. Point 0.7 worked pretty well. Yeah, it just depends on, again, it depends on your frame rate and like what style you want to go for. Okay. Any questions? We have 5 minutes before we go for lunch. Why do we multiply by time dot delta time on the smoothing factor? We're going to talk about frame rate independence later, but effectively, time dot delta time converts from doing something per second to doing something per frame. So if you do transform dot translate, as in you want to move it in some direction. Let's say you want to move it upwards, like this. What this means is move 1 meter upwards per frame. Because we're calling this an update, this is a per frame function, right? And we probably don't want to do things per frame. If this game is running at 30 FPS, this is going to move at 30 meters per second. If the game is running at 300 FPS, it's going to move at 300 meters per second, right? And so to counteract that, we use something called time dot delta time. So if we multiply our value by time dot delta time, we're converting this from 1 meter upwards per frame to 1 meter upwards per second. And what this contains, time dot delta time is just the time since the previous frame. That's what this contains. And so this is the use case for it. So maybe we should not use one because it's going to get simplified away. But yeah, so this is basically how you use time dot delta time. And there's more to this that makes it a little bit more complicated. For example, using the smoothing factor and multiplying it by time dot delta time is actually not correct. It is not the way to make it frame rate independent, but it looks close enough, and in most cases it's going to be accurate enough. If you want to do this correctly for like non-additive quantities, you have to like do weird integration math that is a little annoying. But it works for like additive quantities like position. All right. Did that make sense? I hope that made sense. Lots of people are typing. Would there be a noticeable difference in using lerp for the rotation smoothing instead of slurp? Probably not. It's a common optimization to use lerp instead of slurp. But there is a slight difference. The slight difference is much more pronounced when you're using vectors that are far away from each other. So if you consider this vector here and this vector here, and then we draw some sort of circular like arc. So the thing that happens is that if you have a linear interpolation like this versus an angular interpolation like this, halfway between these two is going to be here. That's going to be there. But then the thing that happens is that halfway on the arc here is going to be over here. Halfway on the line is going to be over here. So if we look at this one, this is 25% of the way. But for the lerp, this is 25% of the way. So you can see that you actually get different rotations. They're going to converge at the halfway point, but then they're going to diverge again. And then they're going to converge at the very end. And so what's going to happen is that the lerp is going to be slow in the beginning and slow at the end, and then it's going to quickly skip past the middle, while slurp is going to smoothly and linearly rotate along the arc. That's the difference. But sometimes for small angles, the difference doesn't really matter much. And so lerp is cheaper. And so sometimes you can get away with using lerp. But for extreme angles like this, where it's pretty wide, then you might have to use slurp instead. All right. I've been like sinking more and more in my chair, and I feel like my back is going to be very angry with me. All right. Anything else before we go for lunch? Because it's actually lunchtime now. shrimp pasta again? Yeah. No more thoughts. Oh, maybe I should fix the bug. Let's do that before we leave. So we had this issue, right? Where it was smoothing toward a target, but as soon as we go outside, it kind of abruptly stops, right? And that looks pretty ugly. Like that doesn't look very nice. We want it to be kind of keep on being smooth, right? So let's fix that. So the problem is that we are only doing this animation while the target is inside the trigger. But what we're going to have to do is we want to animate even if it's outside the trigger, because that's kind of what happens. We're pulling it outside, and then we want this one to keep smoothing, right? We need to move the smoothing itself outside of the if statement. And then what we want to do is that we want to only update the target rotation when it's inside, but we still want to know what the target rotation was after we leave the trigger. So we're going to have to cache this target rotation. So we keep this variable between frames. So even if it's outside, we still remember what the last target rotation was, and then we apply the smoothing. And so now this should give us what we want. Right, we need to hit play. Oh yeah, our value is outdated. I think we use 10 as our smoothing factor. Okay, so now it's smooth, and if we go outside, you can see that it nicely settles, right? Even though it doesn't have the target anymore, it settles. Isn't that cute? Doesn't that look nice? Yeah, so we fixed it. All right. I think that's it. Unless you have any questions about the bug fix, then you are free to go for lunch. We're going to do 1 hour lunch as usual. After this hour, we're going to dive into trigonometry. We're going to start looking at angles, because we've been avoiding angles like the plague until now. So we're going to jump into that right after lunch. For those of you on YouTube, I'm going to end the stream, and I'm going to start a new stream in an hour. So if you're on YouTube, you're going to find the new stream on my channel, I think. I don't know how streams work on YouTube, but it'll be there. We're going to resume in an hour from now. I guess if YouTube has any questions, I can stick around for a little bit longer before I have lunch. How's YouTube? Do you have any questions? Is there a performance difference between different LERPs? Yes, I didn't mention those before, but LERP is cheaper than Slurp, but they work a little bit differently. So if you're doing small angle differences, then if you know that it's just a small angle deviance, then you can just use LERP. Usually works fine. So if it's a large deviation, then you probably want to use Slurp. You can start it with a Premiere in 1 hour. Yes, that's what I'm going to do. But even if I do that, it's sometimes I don't see it on my own channel when I do the Premiere thing. So I don't know how people find it apart from just suggested videos. What's your time zone? Stockholm. Could we do a cone target detection with two dot products? You would only need one dot product for that. If you wanna do a cone like this, this is just a single dot product and a distance measurement. So if you wanna have a cone shape to your turret, then this is the way you would do.
if you want to have a 3D cone with a rounded cap, then a single dot product and a single distance measurement is enough. It's the same principle as this one. Okay. Any other questions before I leave? Oh, and if there are any FutureGames students still sticking around, you can leave. You don't have to be here. You can go have lunch. You are free. I don't know if I made that clear. I'm just sticking around for YouTube. are quaternions less time space consuming than matricial? Is that the word you use for matrices? Matricial computation. In this case, what is the benefit of using quaternions instead of matrices? Quaternions are faster to interpolate and composite. And they also take up very little space. That is the advantage of quaternions, and that's kind of the only reason we use quaternions. There are other representations of rotation that we use, like angle axes, Euler angles, and basis vectors, like we do in rotation matrices, right? So we have many different ways of representing 3D rotation. It just so happens that this really convoluted, annoying thing called the quaternion is faster at doing composition and interpolation. And so that's why quaternions are used. But that is kind of the only reason. Outside of that, every other rotation representation, or especially the rotation matrix and the angle axis rotation format, like both of those are a million times more intuitive, but they don't composite and interpolate as well as the as quaternions. And that's why quaternions are used, unfortunately, because they're very complicated to wrap your head around. But we're gonna talk about rotations. I think we have time to talk about rotations today. I don't think trigonometry is gonna take that long. So I think rotations is gonna be up next. Okay. We briefly touched on them in this so far because we've been using rotations without really talking about them, but we use them just as a vehicle to orient things to vectors, right? Okay, all right. Neat. I think that's it. Okay, this has been bothering me. I have to fix this. There we go. Now I can relax. How different will the calculation for this cert be if it's attached to an object that is also moving and rotating? The biggest difference is that right now we've been calculating the rotation for this cert in world space. If it is violently moving around and doing a lot of stuff like that, you would want to do all of this in local space. So you would want to have the target rotation in as a local rotation, and you would want the current rotation to also be set by local vectors. And so I think that would be the biggest difference. Otherwise, it would be basically the same. Okay. What was the assignments? Read the description of the video. The first link are the assignments. Okay, I'm gonna head off and have lunch. Thank you for joining. I hope this was informative and whatever. And I will see you all in, I guess, 50 minutes or something. Yeah, in 50 minutes. And then we're gonna jump into trigonometry. I hope you're ready. Trigonometry is fun. I like trigonometry. All right, there are a bunch of links to my social media if you want to follow me in other places, in the description of the video. if you want to go to my Discord server, you're welcome to join. There you go. There's a link if you want to hop into my Discord. During my lectures, I am reading the private Discord for my students. So these are different Discords. But if you want to join my Discord surrounding all of the stuff that I do online, then feel free to join. Lots of game developers in there in case you want to hang out with game devs and other creative people. And so feel free to hop in. And yeah, I think that's it. Thanks for joining, and I will see you all in 50 minutes. Bye, everyone.